Welcome to Vote Who with your host for this evening. My name is Amina Taylor. With just days to go before the British general elections, we're tackling the big questions that the mainstream media sometimes finds too hot to handle. Vote Who is live every day at this time until the end of the week. And wherever you are, we invite you to put your questions on election topics to our specialist panel. Today's the day of the third and final leaders' debate in Britain, where Gordon Brown from Labour, Nick Clegg from the Liberal Democrats, and David Cameron from the Conservatives will be on show, just like those ponies. But where are the smaller parties in all of this? Well, at Press TV, we like to give a voice to the voiceless. So joining me today are representatives from two of the slightly smaller parties. With me, on my right, we start off with Shara Ali. He's the Green Party parliamentary candidate for Brent Central, and Hugo Pierre alongside him, who's chair of the Black Members Committee in the Socialist Party. Good evening to you, gentlemen. Nice to have you. If you've got a question you'd like to put to our guests, please call us now. That number for you is +44 208 601 4555, or send us a text on +44 780 000 8066. And if you'd rather contact us via email, then you can do that as well. That email address is votewho@presstv.co.uk to have your question asked live on air. You can also see the numbers at the right-hand corner of your screen, just scrolling up right now. Gentlemen, welcome to the program. As I said before, I'm very grateful you could join us tonight. It's the big three. The leaders are all out there jostling for position. You wouldn't know that by speaking to some of the public, but they're actually more involved in this campaign. Dr. Ali, it's a real time of change. Are you optimistic?
Well, the Green Party's fielding a record number of candidates across the country, over 300, and a full slate, 73. In the general election for the Greater London area, and we've been getting very positive messages from people on the streets and the doorsteps. And in my own Brent Central, I think there's a real appetite for a party who is radical and progressive on social change and the environment at the same time. These two things are bound up, and so wherever there's a policy on climate change, it also has a positive effect on people's pockets and also their quality of life at the same time. And there's also been the expenses scandal, of course, and people, I think, are crying out for difference.
Well, let me just bring you in here, Hugo. The Socialist Party also standing as part of a broader coalition group as well. You very energised by these election process?
I mean, we're obviously going out to do our best to get our message across. We are one of the smaller parties. We are involved in a coalition. But I think you're right when you say there is a real thirst for change. There's a real opportunity out there for change. Something that none of the three mainstream parties represent at the moment. They all represent the same policies.
Well, they might disagree with that.
Well, they generally represent the same policies. And when you go on the doorstep, people are interested to know what would we do that would be different. And I think there's an opportunity, at least in this election, to put across a socialist message. It
All
may
right.
not
well,
translate
let's go,
into
because
votes,
we were
there is
out,
a message
Hugo.
To people.
Let's go to our first question. We were out and about in London, and we approached members of the public. And this is question number one, one of the burning issues.
What is the average working class job going to be in Britain in the future?
I heard that when the Conservatives comes in power, he's going to cut out all child tax credit and child benefit. What is it that the other parties are going to do to prevent that from happening?
Hugo, let me kick things off with your perspective on this first one. What might these working class jobs look like? I mean, they're saying there are no such things as class anymore, but we know that to be the case. Where can the poorer members of society find sustenance in this economic turmoil?
I think, unfortunately, we've already seen over the last few years what working class job looks like as far as the main political parties and as far as the big bosses in industry are concerned. It's minimum wage jobs, particularly for young people, on £5.50, £5, on around about £5 an hour. We also see for, in work, a lot of people in work are now claiming tax credits. And so that's what we see. We think that the big parties would like to maintain for working class people. Again, outsourcing of jobs. Now, we are opposed to that and we will fight that wherever we can. But you see, it doesn't help when perhaps some of the people in perhaps better jobs are being threatened with their terms and conditions. We've seen, for example, just recently the Heathrow, the British Airways workers taking strike action to maintain their terms and conditions. We'd accept that there's some of the better terms and conditions, but why should ordinary people who've put a lot into the company, who really built the profits of those companies, why should they pay for the financial crisis for a second,
because I know that's quite near to your constituency, your prospective constituency. Sure. This is a real danger area, isn't it? People who feel there's nothing out there for them, frankly.
Well, I mean, we are, as the questioners were alluding to, we are facing, you know, massive disparity in society, and that can often breed resentment and crime at the same time. And what the Green Party would do is, first of all, guarantee not just a minimum wage, but a living wage. And that would be funded, for example...
What's the difference there?
Well, the minimum wage isn't enough to live on, actually, particularly if you're in London. And it's not a fair wage. So what we're after is a fair wage. You know, we've got massive disparity in society, you know, with the top bankers still staying in a role in which they're, you know, earning and allocating themselves big bonuses. That's unfair, and that needs to be rectified. So at the same time, you know, if we try and reduce corporation tax on small businesses, for example, that will help them to employ people also at a good wage. And those workers, it's been proven, research shows that people who are paid and rewarded properly also work better, and they have less cause often to take time away from work.
There is something here, though, about talking the talk, but when it comes to the creation of green jobs, when it comes to actually making this work, there's a lot of hot air but no real policy. Hugo, you
well,
first.
I mean, again, I don't know whether you remember and whether your viewers may remember, last year there was the Vestas factory on the Isle of Wight that was actually building wind turbines. That these were real green jobs. Vestas is an American company, and they decided to pull all of their, you know, pull that company and liquidate those particular jobs. And in the Socialist Party, we supported the struggle of those workers to maintain their jobs. In fact, not only did we support their struggle to keep their jobs, we also called for the nationalisation of that particular industry under control of those workers. And we called for investment into that particular industry to make sure that the wind turbines could be continued to be not just built but generated, and real investment put into those jobs. So we think it's exceptionally important that green jobs are created. We think it's, you know, a key.
Dr. Ali, you can weave your answer in another answer for one of the next questions going up. Let's hear what another viewer had to say.
I'm a student from Luxembourg, and I'm a Muslim myself, and I've noticed in this country that there's a bit of racism towards the Muslims, and because of the media stereotypes, and I was wondering whether the main politicians can do anything about that.